break tonight.
Oh, thank you.
Make a motion to open up tonight's meeting.
John Melcher, I move to open tonight's meeting.
Second. Second by me.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Susan Elwell.
John Melcher.
Mm-hmm.
Charlie Costello.
Frank Martin.
We're recording it here, we're not recording it on the machine.
Oh.
Okay, well, we have a brief summer meeting tonight, but probably the most important agenda of our summertime and springtime is our annual update from the Northeast Mosquito Control. And I'm sure it'll be on TV, and I'm sure people will be interested in what you have to say. So you're the company or governmental agency that the town contracts with every year, and you submit a management plan to us that we review every year with your recommendations, and you're funded through the town to keep an eye on the different types of mosquito nuisances that we have. And so Roy Melnick, you're the executive director. Are you going to make the first presentation?
Yes, I'll do the introduction.
And speak up so we can...
Okay. My name is Roy Melnick. I'm the new executive director. I started in this position in November of 2017, and on the board for about 8 months now. And we started up the season a little bit slower because of the cold weather and the water, and it was actually pretty good because it beat the mosquitoes. When it rains, it pounds the surface of the water, and the lava, they can't breathe, and they drown. So it was a really good season. We got a good head start on the catch basins, I think we got about half of our communities done now. Today we actually did an air spray at Rowley.
On the salt marsh?
That'll be tomorrow, in Rowley.
A lava side?
Yes, BTI.
Let him continue for the preface, and then you can...
So we started with the catch basins, and then we did lava siding, which is in the marshes and the swamplands, the wetlands. That's a granular pesticide that goes into the water, and it kills the lava before they hatch and become mosquitoes.
That's mostly on the salt marsh, right?
Right, salt marsh, and also in some of the fresh waters that
okay.
we also treat as well. And then we've done an aerial spray in June. We did 3,400 acres in five different communities, Raleigh being one of them. And today, Bill was out with the crew, and they sprayed half of those 3,000 acres, and tomorrow, Raleigh is getting its share to be sprayed tomorrow. There's a lot of lava out in the marshlands right now from the heat over the weekend. So if we hit it today and tomorrow, that'll kill them all for the month for the last couple of weeks for July.
And is that BTI that you're dropping?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
And then maybe one more aerial spray in August. So things are looking really good. There's no West Nile or Triple E anywhere in our district. We're 32 towns anywhere in Essex County or a few towns outside of Essex. There's been some out in Norfolk and West Norfolk County and up in Worcester area. But we've been fortunate, and as soon as if we do identify some, we'll let the local boards kind of become aware of it, and we'll put the property alerts out to the community. Right now we're at a low risk in our area. Winthrop was raised to be a little bit moderate risk because it's close to Norfolk County. But other than that, the season's going really well. And I'll let Bill and Kim give you some more specifics.
All right.
Which one would like to go?
Yeah, I'll do the operations.
And you're Bill Mahaffey,
operations manager, yep, for Northeast Mass Mosquito Control. Like Roy mentioned, our spring larva siding was a little delayed because of the weather, cold and wet. Then it quickly turned hot, and things started to dry up faster than we expected. So we took care of upland pools, wetlands, woodland pools in all the communities. And then by, I think it was May 4th was the first Monday, we started doing catch basins, and I'm sorry, it was June. We were delayed a whole month because of the wet spring. We started catch basins in the communities on June 4th. Rowley.
And by that, you put BTI in the basins?
Yeah, we use two different products. One's Alpacid, which is a insect growth regulator, and we also have a Vectomax product, which is a BT product, which has a BS, which is Bacillus sphericus, which has a longevity with that. We tend to get 3 months of treatment out of the basins, which is good.
Almost the whole season.
Yeah, when they're clean, yeah, pretty much the whole season. So we started basins in Rowley. I always coordinate with the DPW, and Pat Snow said that they always clean in the fall. So we got right on Rowley, hearing that information, and we had all the basins in town done, except for Christopher Road, which was being repaved, and they tend to, those basins,
they're
repaving, they cover, so they don't get anything, you know, foreign material down. So we had the first treatment, 588 basins done by June 11th, and then Kim went back on the 27th of June and treated the ones in Christopher, in the streets off of that,
Intervale,
I believe, Circle, another 14. So 602 basins in Rowley this year. So by the 27th of June, everything was done. We, as Roy mentioned, we also did our first aerial larva sighting of the salt marsh by helicopter on June 19th and 20th, Raleigh being done on the 19th, 608 was total, that with BTI, liquid BTI. That went really good. We got a really good efficacy with that.
And then, how do you measure that?
We go out, we do pre and post dips.
Pre
and post aerial spray dips. Yes, and we have, each community typically has 10 different dip sites across the marsh. It's like a cross section of the total marsh area in each town. Not to say we don't do more dips than that. You know, if you can't find them, we a lot of times tend to go beyond those dip stations, further out of the marsh, and you know, continue to look for larvae. We had a pretty good population in June, and we had a really good, I'd say probably about 95% efficacy with that. BTI works really well for mosquitoes. They don't tend to get immune to it either, or it's because they feed. It's how they feed. They ingest the material, and it's different from trying to spray and all that. It's you know, it's the way they feed is they're the filter feeders, and they ingest the material, and it basically blows their gut up, so they can't.
Makes crystals in there.
Oh, yeah. So they never reach adult. They never get out of the
correct
water.
Correct. That's
so easier to treat.
Easy to treat. Yeah. You're not chasing them at that point. Yeah. And so we'll do, like tomorrow, we'll do Rowley in the morning, and then on Wednesday morning, I'll go out and check in our 10 dip stations and see what we got for a kill. So that'll be tomorrow. And other than that, Kim can talk about surveillance and get into a little bit of the testing that has been done so far.
So we set traps out normally on the middle of May, and that gives us a couple weeks before the lab starts getting, before we really start our season, to make sure all our traps are working, get our schedules down. You know, it's kind of like a dry run, but we like to see what we're getting for spring mosquitoes, because it can be a good indicator of what we're going to see for the rest of the year. You know, there's 53, 54 different kinds of mosquitoes in Massachusetts. Each one has a different habitat. Each one has different feeding preferences. About 12 to 15 of those are potential vectors of disease. And some of them are bridge vectors, which means they can give the virus from birds to people. And then the primary vectors, which are in catch basins and red maple swamps for Tripoli, which would be the QC of Melanura, those are primary vectors. So they get it from the birds, and then they'll feed on the birds, and a couple of birds will have West Nile or Tripoli. Mosquitoes feed on those birds, then the mosquitoes go feed on non-infected birds, and then it amplifies the virus in the bird population. So by the time July and August comes around, you have a large bird population that's positive for these viruses. Then you have the bridge vector mosquitoes, the salt marsh, the cattail swamp, the ones in parking lot puddles, the ones that bite people. They'll bite birds, pick up the virus, and then they'll transmit it to people. And that usually happens later in the season. And we'll see that anywhere from July to sometimes into October, till the first heavy frost, and usually a heavy frost is two consecutive days under 32 degrees. Is it two consecutive days? Something like that.
Days or nights, or?
Either one.
It has to be a hard frost, not like a leaf frost, it has to be a ground frost.
Yep.
So, you know, a killing frost.
When you see white on the grass.
Yeah, it has to be several of those in a row. So we can have a pretty long virus season for people. That's why every time I'll do the BMPs, I kind of make the dates a little later sometimes. I'll say protect yourself until, it used to be October, now it's November, you know, or September to October. So we're seeing changes due to climate variables and droughts. We're seeing differences in populations and virus times and stuff. So we try to give it a good space. So I start submitting to the lab. I put out my traps and I collect. I have certain sites that I have. I did change your site in Raleigh. It's a historic site. I wasn't getting a lot of mosquitoes in it, and I did change it to a prior historic site. So now it's been reverted back to where we're actually getting mosquitoes that we've had hits in the past. So this year I've already sent in 6 pools, 1 per week, since trapping season started on June 15th. So you've had 6 submissions of Culex species, primary vectors. And the other site, we didn't submit until 8/6. So we're getting a lot more submissions a lot earlier. It's kind of a better site, so I feel more, this is more of a promising site.
But that doesn't say that it's a better year for getting mosquitoes.
No, it just means it's a better site.
Your traps are better placed.
Better placed, right. And sometimes you have to move them out of the urban because we treat the basins. So when we treat basins well, we'll get less mosquitoes in the traps that are set in those sites. So sometimes we may have to switch them around. We try not to move them frequently because we like to have historic numbers. I like to have comparisons. So even when I do your BMP for next year, I'm going to have to note that that's a change. And we can't really get a good comparison until we do 2 years in a row at that new site. So that's how that would work. But what we like to see is these early submissions are our primary vector species, the ones that are feeding on birds. If those come back positive, that means it's in the bird population in some percentage that makes it a risk later on for having other species pick it up later. So what we do is if we get a positive, these are early indicator traps. When we get a positive in these traps with this Culex species, we'll put out a supplemental trap. I'll focus on a high density area such as a school, a town center, public place, a park, where we get a lot of people and could have a lot of mosquitoes. So there's a lot of things I look at, a lot of variables that you'll read in the BMP or in the Integrated Pest and Vector Management Plan. It's demographics, it's human population, it's mosquito populations, and then what activities you guys have at night. So once I find those sites, I put a supplemental trap. Those are species that will bite people. Those get sent to the lab. If those come back positive, then we call and we notify the Board of Health if we have to do any kind of spray. Block, small area. I mean, we've been doing more small areas. We don't do citywide as much anymore. We'll focus on block areas. And we've had good luck with that. It's minimal, it's direct, it's quick. And we haven't, every time we've done that last year, started doing it last year. And every time we had that, we didn't have any other positives for the rest of the year in those communities. So it's less invasive.
Beverly was a good example.
Yeah. So we had positive after positive after positive, and when we finally did their good block spray, just the perimeter around the traps that I set for supplementals, they had nothing for the rest of the year. And the rest of the year, I mean, they had nothing for the end of August, September, and October. So, which was really good. So we've been focusing on that instead of doing like a huge citywide spray, because we're not seeing it in all the areas. Even though it doesn't mean it's not there, we're focusing on mosquito populations and density. So we're looking at risk areas.
And public health.
Right.
So that's kind of where that is. But so far, it's working out well, but we haven't had any positives yet in Raleigh. And we still have a couple more weeks to go before we really start seeing it in our district.
Well, it sounds, I have a few questions. Do you have any questions?
Yeah, go ahead.
If you pick up, how do you get birds to dead birds to check?
There's the state lab does not collect dead birds anymore. A lot of bird populations have built immunity to it. It used to be West Nile was a new virus, and the crows we had are New World crows, and the Old World crows in Europe were adjusted to the West Nile virus. Ours weren't. Since we've had West Nile since 99, the populations had massive decrease, and now they have an immunity. They've built in some kind of immunity to West Nile.
The ones who survived.
Right, so they breed and they survive, and they have that survival gene, so they have that built-up immunity going forward. The other reason they don't collect birds anymore is birds travel. So when you look at crows, they travel 50 to 100 miles a day on a feeding schedule. So if one drops in the backyard, you never know where it came from, what the radius was, if it got it from grooming, if it got it from a mosquito, because West Nile can be transmitted to a crow population by preening, nesting, roosting, mating. It can be transmitted through fecal matter and saliva. So birds were really not a good indicator of focal points for disease.
The DPH gave up on us submitting them our residents. It's been quite a few years ago. I want to say maybe
it's been at least
eight to ten years. They were getting inundated with them and said, yeah, it's in the population, what are we going to do, you know? So they kind of gave up on it.
And what truck or type of equipment do you use for the block spray? Is it that little white Ranger that I see with the...
It's a small pickup truck. We've updated our fleet. we have some Chevy Colorados now.
They're probably all white.
They're all white, yes.
All have the insignia.
Correct.
So people see those things around.
Yes. I think the ones people have seen in town were doing catch basins. So, because there's a Raleigh Talks page on Facebook, and there were a lot of comments on that about, what's that?
That was me in the Ford F-150, so that's a bigger truck with a white, it was a white truck with insignia doing catch basins.
But people wondered what that truck was doing, and the first thing they think of is spraying. Well, no, we're not spraying.
All our trucks have the seals.
I wanted to stress
so
that.
It's very identifiable.
I'm sure there's an interested audience tonight.
And we do those during the day, and we have our flashing lights, so it is noticeable, for safety and stuff like that. But we do our catch basin treatments during the day.
And if you see one of our white trucks out at night, we spray on Thursday nights in the evening so that the bees are back in their honeymoons. And it doesn't harm
my
bees.
Well, the product labeling that we use for the ZFX product doesn't allow us to do any spraying until after sunset anyway,
That's when the mosquitoes are active, because they're airborne, and our spray is to kill all the ones that are airborne.
Yeah. For the public, and for us, what kind of repellents would you recommend for people to buy and use?
Well, I can't recommend a name brand.
Does the Mahaffey Farm make a repellent? I'm only kidding.
I can give you the product ingredients. The CDC, the CDC, Centers for Disease Control, recommends products with DEET.
How much DEET? Because there's
also... The percentage varies based on your use and what you're applying, the length of time, and if you're applying to a child or an adult. And our website that we have has the link to the CDC's repellent page that gives the exact usage for repellents and can give you the breakdown. So there's lemon eucalyptus, that's CDC approved, a certain blend of lemon eucalyptus oil. And there's DEET and there's picaridin, which is a clothing treatment. So you can treat your clothing, and it's an insecticide that treats and lasts for washes. But the CDC, Centers for Disease Control repellent page is a very good tool to guide a resident on what to use, but it should, if you're going to be using a repellent for mosquitoes and ticks to prevent disease, the CDC page recommendation should be followed precisely on what the products that are approved for use for prevention of disease.
So you're highly recommending going on the Center for Disease, the federal
CDC page, yes. And our website has links. We have a very simplified view. We designed a new website last year
very user-friendly.
And we have it on the bottom of the business cards that we gave you. And if you want to read it out to the audience.
Yeah.
And it also shows our vehicles, it gives a description of our equipment, it shows our product labeling, so they can click on our label and they can see what we use for products. It has user guides, is how to protect themselves against mosquito-borne disease, how to treat their houses, to protect their screens, and how to empty water containers. So that it's a very modernized, updated site that's user-friendly, directs them exactly to the page they're looking for without having to meander through the web to find what they're looking for.
Right.
It's exact links to, and also on that, we have an update.
You got your glasses, oh.
Hey, Rick.
I can't see.
You want to use her glasses or?
No, no.
You can see, yeah.
Okay. And we also, on that page, have an update and a link to the Department of Agricultural Resources Property Exclusion from Pesticides page. They can go to that and they can fill out a pesticide, a wide area pesticide exclusion. Although we don't do, you know, spraying like we do in some other communities, they can still fill out from January 1st to December 31st. It's only good for a year, but they can go online, they can fill out an online submission form to exclude their property. It has to be the property they own, and they can exclude their property from adult siding, and if it's over an acre of larvaciding. So if it's a small puddle in their front yard, no, but if it's if they own way more than an acre of wetland, they can actually have that excluded so we don't do any larvaciding either. So that's a useful tool for them as well. But it only lasts a year. You have to do it every year.
I can tell you our website. It's NE, which stands for Northeast.
Yeah,
it's
kind of read it. Go ahead.
It's Northeast.
Susan, no, let Susan.
It's all right.
She likes the camera.
She likes the camera. All right.
It doesn't like me.
The limelight.
It's, we'll put the www.NEMASSMOSQUITO.org.
Simple.
It's NEMASSMOSQUITO.org.
Yep.
Yep. Great.
And it is a very, very useful website.
Yeah.
We do put links to viruses on there too, so they can see the risk that the state has on municipalities. We also have a link for what we do for services in your community, so they can click on Rowley or they can click on whatever town they live in, and it'll show what services we offer, which is similar to the BMP setup. It's just a really user-friendly, very informative website, very, very transparent.
Do you think for Rowley, a town that has loads of salt marsh and loads of wetlands, the plan that we've worked with you cooperatively over the years is the best thing we should be doing for now?
It's the best management plan. It's something that we all work on as a team at Northeast Mass Mosquito, and we also work with your Board of Health and the members here. And if there's some fine tuning that needs to be done, Kim writes the plan in the early part of the year, January, February, sends it to the Board of Health for your review. If there's any modifications that need to be changed, we think it's the best management practice to date for each one of our towns. And we're open to suggestions if you have some improvements that can help us out. And if we see that there's an area that needs to be tweaked or improved, we'll recommend them to your Board of Health. But we don't make any changes unless we'll recommend them, you guys agree to them, and then we'll make those changes.
And of course, you're taking weekly, you're looking at what's going on.
Right, weekly,
daily, sometimes.
Daily, yeah.
And you're keeping records so that next year's plan might be changed because of.
Well, it could be instead of a West Nile risk, we could be looking at wet years and we could be looking at a Triple E risk. So, you know, even just within the years we're looking at for. Climate can change mosquitoes and change viruses. So while we have drought years, we have West Nile. When we get wet years, we have Triple E. We are starting to see that mosquito population starting to come back. And it is cyclical. So, you know, these can, but we look at them for a long period of time and I track them. And that's why I like historic traps, because then I can see a pattern of mosquitoes and population densities in the area, so I can judge what it might be like next year or what we are going to see. future.
Or if there are new mosquitoes moving into a particular area that were not there before, that's an indicator that we might have to do something else.
Maybe we should change our zoning rate.
I have a question. A lot of folks in our neighborhood have a private company come in to spray for mosquitoes. Will that affect your traps if they get, if they trap anywhere near where you're?
They're only spraying that particular property, a barrier spray with foliage around it and maybe what's up in the air at the time of the spray. We don't have traps in the backs of.
You don't have any place
like
that.
Are there specific sites that are protected from that kind of spray behavior?
We have some towns that they're adamant that we don't do any adulticiding, but that topic came up at a Board of Health meeting, and it's like, well, do you realize how many independents are out there on a day-to-day basis?
There are a lot out there.
Yeah, beyond our
control. Right,
I know.
You don't have,
they do it during the day.
You know, they're independents, they're not part of the state. We have no say over that. Department of Ag sometimes, they don't really know either what.
They do check on them when, you
know.
Yeah, they
do check on them, but they're out of their control.
Yeah.
You know, we're a state agency and we have strict guidelines for here too, so.
You know, unless you do ordinances or something, there's really, you know, not a lot that can be done.
So if a bird picks up equine encephalitis virus, does it kill the bird?
Not always. Some bird populations carry them. They're looking at eastern equine encephalitis used to be a winter residing virus in bird populations and migratory birds. So it was more like Florida, the southern states during the winter, and then because they look at genetics. So they're looking at different strains of the virus and where they originate from. A lot of the viruses strains in the birds that we found or in the mosquitoes that we found originated from southern states. Now they're starting to see, in the past 10 years, they're starting to see some strains of the virus that originated from New Hampshire or Virginia or Maryland. They're not going very far. Or Connecticut. So now they're looking at the potential for wood thrushes, turkeys, those types of birds that may be harboring them or just keeping them in their system throughout the winter. Also the potential that reptiles such as snakes may be a reservoir for this virus, so it doesn't have to go very far. So then we do have mosquito species that only feed on reptiles and amphibians. So there's a lot of theoretical stuff that's going on as to where these viruses go in the winter. They still haven't, you know, there's a lot of research that they're doing. But normally what the common rule right now is that they're in migratory bird populations. They come in when the birds nest. So these birds have them, they nest in large groups in the swamps. This particular mosquito comes out early in the spring, feeds on those roosting, nesting birds, and the fledglings can't fly away or protect themselves, they're bare chicks. So they get a good ready supply of blood from these chicks, and they can just transmit these viruses within these songbird migratory groups, you know, these roosting birds, the small, I'm having a loss at kind of, they're songbirds. They're the small songbirds.
Sparrows.
No, mostly birds that live in wetlands and things. And depending on how wet it is.
Red-winged blackbirds, probably.
Yep. Anything that nests in swamps. So, you know, we've seen patterns where if we get a really heavy, wet spring, some of these birds don't nest here. They'll move north, and they'll nest in drier spots. And we see focal, you know, eastern equine focuses like in Bangor, Maine, which we don't really see. But we said, okay, well, it's been raining, and it chased those birds further north. That's where they nested. So then you get a focal point for a triple E up there. So there's a lot of, it's very hard to track it down. But we just look at it as it's coming in. There may be resident birds that have it and keep it through the winter, but it's mostly birds that come up in during migratory routes. So.
And why, for years and years, do we see not so much West Nile, but the equine encephalitis showing up in southeastern Massachusetts?
There's a lot of swamps there. There's a lot of red mate. The mosquito that transmits the primarily feeds on this and amplifies that virus. There's a lot of big swamps down there, a lot of the red maple, the old,
white cedar,
the cryptic. And this mosquito doesn't live in the open, it lives in these rot holes of roots of trees that nothing else lives in, and it can't be accessed by predators, and it has to be freeze safe, because they stay larvae in the winter, they stay alive as larvae in the winter in the water that's down there, so they can't freeze, they don't want to be accessed by predators, and
they're hard to control.
They're hard to control,
really hard to control,
and they need to have, when they come out as adults in the early, like April, there's nothing better than having a nest, a whole bunch of fresh birds to feed on that are nesting that aren't going to go anywhere or fight them off. So these focal points also come in these areas too. So you'll see concentrations of Tripoli in those. So we call them their historic Tripoli areas.
Yeah,
and shows every state has
yeah.
one.
Plymouth
yeah.
County and Bristol, there's one
yeah.
huge swamp, Pockamuck
swamp.
Yep, and that's
that
where it
spans
is, yeah.
the two counties, and that's a big focal point.
Yep.
So the state has done numerous aerial sprays down there by airplane.
And then we'll also see it in areas where the topographic differences. So where the sea coast meets the land, there's these old ridges of bogs, it's acid bogs and swamps, because they do like a low pH of 3 to 4. So along the whole eastern seaboard, due to the formation of soils and everything like that, and just geological formations, there's this type of swamps and bogs in this area all the way up the eastern seaboard. So those are the pocket areas where we're going to see a lot more of the eastern equine virus. Mm-hmm. So.
Do you use the state digital orthophoto wetland data?
On our,
for your
on our GIS.
And your GIS
there.
Yeah, a lot of it we map ourselves. We do have a new program now that we've been working on for about a year and a half, and it's a field seeker program. It's an integrated pest management tool that's a lot of mosquito control districts around the country are using. It maps our treatment areas, it maps the acreage, it maps the product, it maps our requests, our resident requests by name and location and what we've done, and it keeps a historical record. We also use it now, not just for boards of health resident requests, we also do it for our adult siting. So it tracks, it keeps a list of our residents. When we have a resident that calls and wants us to check their property, we put it in this field seeker system. It pops up on all our iPhones and Android phones, and I have a tablet, and then I can take it out in the field, and I can do a field visit, take photographs if I want, put notes in. It records everything in the database. I can use a treatment. It tells me how much product, what the acreage was, and you know, so it keeps control of that. And then I submit it, and we complete the request. And then we can set an interval. So if I find that it's a site that I have to go back 30 days from now, I can set an interval so it'll automatically tell me to go back 30 days and recheck that site. So it's a very useful system. For my mapping of some of these reports, I do use the GIS, the Massachusetts GIS, and we use it with our GIS database that we have at the office. But we're trying to consolidate everything into one program so it's efficient, quick, and with all the technology out there, we have to be more advanced.
I mapped all those that's my what I did for a living. I mapped all those wetlands that are in that database. But it's good. This field seeker sounds like a great tool for you.
We're still working out some bugs with it. We're working with We're working with a software company, and we're actually helping them write the program and tweak it into what our needs are in our county. So we're a year and a half, almost 2 years into the system now. And each year we come up with more improvements and give it back to them. And actually the other districts are now kind of jumping on board and maybe we'll have a statewide field seeker. So we're like the pioneers.
Good. I have a good friend who I met when I was in my wetlands mapping career, David Henley from
East Middlesex.
He's still active?
He's retired.
Oh, has he?
But he is working. Yeah, he comes in maybe... he said 12, 15 hours a week to help out. He was out of East Middlesex, which is in
Reading.
Waltham.
Yeah.
Reading and
Wakefield, maybe.
Cambridge. It's that whole great of Boston, kind of northwest section of Boston. So.
Okay. Well, I thank you for coming. It's been 35 minutes of facts and science.
Well, thank you for inviting us, we appreciate it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Give us the opportunity to explain to the community what we do and what you guys do.
We're always open to any resident who wants to call and ask us questions or send us an email. Just go to our website and our contact information is there, and we make house visits, so.
If you can't remember the website, just type in Northeast Mass Mosquito Control, and it will pop up.
Okay.
Question?
No.
Any new viruses that you're tracking that are moving up from the south coast?
There's a few. There's Jamestown Canyon.
Which isn't overall a new virus, but it's, would be new to this area.
Moving further.
Well, yeah, there's more of it.
Yeah, there's more of it.
It's kind of a historic, I mean, it's always been an endemic virus, but it's starting to kind of pop up here and there. As far as the Zikas and all those, they're tropical. They tend to have a tendency to come in fast, strong, and burn out just as fast and go away, which is pretty much what Zika did, and that's what kind of a lot of these other ones do, chikungunya. They come in, they do what they need to do, and then they kind of leave, and then they get replaced by something else. We are tracking new and invasive mosquito species that have the potential for transmitting any diseases that may be new or tropical. We have traps for that. We are watching for those mosquitoes. We work with the state in setting traps for those mosquitoes, so they're helping us too in identifying them. We go to many, many meetings, and I get emails from the DPH all the time as to what new mosquitoes and new viruses are coming. So as soon as we know, you know, and we usually update our pest management plan, the big one that we have, the integrated pest and vector management plan. That one shows what we have for endemic, and it also shows you what travel related that are coming. So I usually try to update those every winter so that you'll know what might be coming.
And where do these new species come from? Are they all coming from warmer places to the north, or?
They come in on tires and in boat hauls, and they travel, you know, so people bring them with them where they go. A lot of it is in the tire trade. Used tires come up from the south or just in transit on boats and things, and then they get discarded. And so we do have a, you know, disposing of tires properly is a very important part of mosquito control. And a lot of these mosquitoes love containers, so any container breeding areas, that's why we like people to dump them, because it's good to practice it now. Clean your gutters, your containers, get rid of your tires properly, poke holes in things, because if we ever do get some of these invasive mosquitoes, once they latch on, it's very hard to get rid of them. You know, eradicating mosquitoes is impossible. So it's better that we watch for them and try to get good habits in keeping your yards free of debris and containers for mosquito breeding purposes. And then when we do get something, it's a lot easier to control.
I have a question too. Weren't you doing something about greenheads?
We have
traps for them?
Yeah, we're the ones that put all the black boxes on the marsh.
Yeah.
That's a separate program, North Shore Greenhead Fly Control.
Yeah.
Raleigh used to be in the program years ago. I've been here 20 plus years, and I never put a trap in Raleigh. So the ones you see at the town landing, those are Ipswich, on the side of the river. But Ipswich, we put out 200 traps in Ipswich, 40 in Salisbury, 40 in Essex. Essex rejoined. They didn't rejoin, I should say, they didn't join mosquito control, but they joined for greenheads.
Control.
Yeah.
Huh.
Years ago, Essex was in the program. They dropped out because at one point they said, well, we can make our own boxes. And you know, they have a huge tourist industry with restaurants, Woodmans, and all of those.
River cruises.
The river cruises. And to my knowledge, nobody in the town ever built their own boxes. So they came back in, I think this is their fourth year back in the Greenland program. So yeah, we put out 415 traps from Seabrook Line in Salisbury to Ipswich, and then also Saugus. They have some salt marsh down there on the Lynn Line. We put out 25 traps. So it's something you might want to consider in the future. We used to put traps out near Neil Pearlie's, the landing, and kind of on the Raleigh side, some going up the river and then down below the railroad bridge around Bachelor's Landing, where Ruth Alexander used to live.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so it's, you know, throw it out there, it's, you know, we do collect a lot of flies.
I've asked you before, ages ago, when you were here, what the cost is. What is the?
Right now, where we replacing some of our older traps, the price right now is $78 per trap. That includes us placing them on the marsh, baiting them, bringing them in, cleaning them, repairing any, painting them, and storing them. So.
So each trap that you request would be a $78 recurring charge each year. So if you had 10 traps.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
And this
year.
Called
you last week. My garage was full of them.
Well, I was on Pine Island Road in Newbury last Tuesday, and the traps, I mean, I swore they were going to lift off the ground. There were so many flies in them. This year, there's a lot of flies.
Uh-huh.
But,
nice healthy marshes.
Yeah.
Nice healthy bugs.
I think we should make a motion not to give Frank a raise next year.
Put him into traps.
And buy traps.
I'm just saying, it's something you may want to consider. You know, a few more traps in the river wouldn't hurt by any means. Railroad Ave, I always say complaints for people.
Yeah,
at least try it. If they don't work, we'll let, because we're measuring the
So if we did decide, because we've discussed this, we've been thinking about this, would that be part of our annual? So
no.
It's be a separate contract with you?
It's a separate program from mosquito control. Yeah, it would be a separate.
So what we would do, we would request a quote from you for X number of traps, and you'd get back, and we'd approve it.
Right,
and then
we'd
go put them out.
And I wouldn't wait till like June to say, you know, we want traps.
Oh, no.
Because we, right now, we have a few extras. We'd have to gear up, and, you know, if you wanted 10 traps.
We build them.
We build them.
This winter.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it'd be, you know,
how long is a trap? What's the lifetime of a trap? 10 years?
Probably, I think with the wooden traps and the with minor repairs, probably 6 to 8 years. You know, they're out in all kinds of weather.
Oh, sure.
I would think 6 to 8 years. But see, we replace some traps that are beyond repair every year. So that price is basically covers all of that.
Right.
You know, it wouldn't be like, oh, we've got to build 10 traps for you. Well, your traps that you have this year may go to Salisbury next year. It's, it, you know.
Right, you don't buy the actual trap, right?
No, correct.
There's no name
correct.
On it.
There's no name for
John Melcher traps.
They all go in and they all go out.
Yeah.
Well, we'll be talking about that.
Yeah, and like I said, you know, usually we request towns if they want more traps or want to come in to the program, usually by February. It gives us time, you know, at the end of the winter to build a few and go from there. So.
Well, thank you for coming.
Thank you for having us.
Oh, one more question.
Are there any retention ponds in town that you think we should be concerned about in your travels around?
You should speak up, Frank. I don't know if you heard that.
Yeah. Any retention ponds in town that you think we should be looking at? Or might need some larvicide?
Most retention ponds, Kim just said that most she's seen are dry.
Yeah, they're mostly dry right now. It's just so dry everywhere.
It depends on how they're built. I never liked the ones that had clay liners because
they
never dry out. Groveland has a few, and I remember years ago when I was doing a lot of larviciding, every week I'd go to be a new batch of mosquitoes that could treat it again. Mm-hmm. And you know, if they perk, that's the best thing.
And you really don't want them filling up with vegetation either, so you want to keep them mowed, because when we get cattails in them, the transition starts to some sort of wet area.
Yeah.
And it also starts breeding another type of mosquito that comes out in June, like now. The ones that are all salt and pepper, that are obnoxious.
They're big.
They're big, and they're not the salt marsh ones, but they're the cattail mosquitoes, and those come out all at once during late June, early July, and they won't go away now for another week or two. I mean, that's where we're getting a lot of our calls from, is they're getting worse and worse every year, and they come from cattail areas. So any of these, you know, they should be mowed and maintained, so any retention detention ponds, no clay liner, and make sure they're mowed and kept free of debris.
I've always had an issue with retention slash detention ponds, because,
It's getting political now.
It is, well, yeah, this is my opinion, but still, when you think about it, a lot of new developments go in, it's part of the drainage that's required.
Oh, it is.
You know, to slow down stormwater, but who maintains them? You know, the developer goes away, and it may be on, you know, an easement, and the town a lot of times doesn't take care of it. Rowley's really good at keeping their roadsides clear, I gotta give, Pat credit for that and his crew, but, retention ponds and basins, a lot of times we'll find ones that have been built 20 years ago now have trees growing in them.
Yep.
And it's a tough thing, you know, to maintain, so.
And that's a conflict between different regulations, because
Right, right.
One town board requires it.
Right.
And if they don't include maintenance as part of the contract.
Right, which we always promote.
Yep.
You know, it's gotta be maintained.
Maintained.
Yep, you're right, you're absolutely right.
And then some of them want cattails in them, because cattails are phytoremediation plant and can absorb toxins and chemicals.
Yep.
So it.
But then it's a whole nother mosquito.
And then it's a whole other mosquito problem.
On three.
So then you gotta make sure it perks, so that whatever cattails grows doesn't collect water at any given time, because you can still have cattails in a perking system without having standing water in it. So, you know, it's just the whole nice, move some water around, you know, don't let it sit there too long.
Right.
Any more questions?
Well, this one that comes up on occasion is next to Market Basket, and.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's checked, periodically. It doesn't tend to breed. Which, you know, if that eases your mind, but, you know, we do, like Kim has free, I won't say she has free days all the time, but once in a while on a Friday something, she'll say, hey, what do you got? And she'll go out and, you know, check a few of these sites, resident requests and things like that.
So you'd go out and dip a little pan.
Yeah.
And cup and see what's squirming around.
Right.
I gauge it by, just because we find a larvae in there doesn't mean we treat it. There's specific types of larvae I'm looking for. I mean, certain mosquitoes we don't need to be concerned with, so we might not treat. Other mosquitoes are bridge vectors or primary vectors, those 12 to 15 species, those that we focus on. So we're very direct on our treatments. We don't just go around and just treat stuff because there's two larvae in there. We look at what's around, what other organisms are in there, if it's in check. You know, if we see a lot of other aquatic organisms, and we get five larvae, it's gonna take care of itself. We're looking at sites that breed the mosquitoes that have problems and in high densities, such as the soybean moon. Mm-hmm. We have also pictures on our website of a dip full of salt marsh larvae. It's black, the entire dish is full. There's gotta be 10,000, 15,000 mosquito larvae in there from one dip. We'll see that in catch basins for Culex. We'll see that sometimes in flooded lawns with Culex or Vexans, which is another one in floodwater, parking lot puddles that sit there wet for a long period of time. So they're specific. It's not all wetlands, and it's not every wetland, and it's not all the time. That's why we go out and we check and dip, and we have certain criteria before we treat anything. So we're always checking. Yeah. It's science. It's very, very direct.
And the crew, for the most part, if they dip a site and find larvae, they'll bring it into
Kim. Bring it back to me, and I'll identify it.
So.
And we can decide whether we treat it or not.
Yeah.
So even in the spring, when we go out larviciding in the spring, some areas have vernal pools, they're checked by, they're all fine. We don't need to treat those, they're not disease-carrying mosquitoes. They may be pestiferous, and it could be a parking lot puddle, a woodland pool that has no frog eggs or anything but mosquito larvae, and the one next to it has frog eggs and a couple of larvae. We're gonna treat this one, we're not gonna touch that one. So it's constantly, you know, all our people are very highly trained to identify areas that need treatment, not areas that don't, so.
Last question, is Walter having a good retirement?
I haven't talked with him in a while. He spends winters in Florida and the rest of the time on Cape Ann, so I know he was, you know, part-time job at a golf course mowing the greens, so. I don't know if he's still doing that. I've been talking to him probably in a year, but he was was doing well.
Good. We talked with him for many years.
Yes, yep.
And I grew up with he and his family.
That's right, so. And his brother Billy, who you probably know,
sure.
William, he still works for us.
Oh.
This is probably his last year as a seasonal employee now.
Uh-huh.
But he worked 30-odd years as a full-time. And then retired and came back as doing, you know, treating catch basins and the such, so.
Yep. Well, thank you for coming.
Thank you for having us.
Anytime.
We'll see you next year.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Very nice to meet you.
Thank you.
Good job.
Yep.
Thank you.
Good job.
Good luck.
Nice to see you.
Thank you.
All right, well, next up, it's 7:15, but it's 7:52, but that was a good information session, I guess.
Yes.
And then if you do get the, look up the date of our TIC presentation a number of years ago, and we'll get that available. So, good.
Sure.
Review of bills next. Any money this week?
A little bit, probably not as much as.
red week, did we?
No, not really.
Nice.
Just don't stop. Really, bro.
This is actually from last year. Not specific.
What's this bill? The Frank's daughter's scholarship.
That's a good
college
idea.
Fund.
Archie Johnny's scholarship fund?
Yeah.
$20,000 a month.
Understand our light bill.
What are we doing with that?
I think it runs that refrigerator.
The freezer.
But do we really use it?
From what they say, do we?
We don't need it for the birds.
No, we use it. Animal control uses it.
For
when he picks up.
Rabies questions.
Gin and tonics. All right, that's the last bill. And so let's, do we have minutes to review?
You do have minutes.
Good.
All right. That's my 20.
Looks more like hours. That's a lot to write.
Just so you remember, the vector management plan is for the entire district, and then the management plan for each town. So if you do want to change it, you can.
No, we'll
certainly. I mean, not maybe not for this year, but when it comes out again next year.
Yeah.
If there's anything that you do.
Well, we rely on
their expertise.
You can see tonight, they know what they're doing.
And there's 30 towns.
30 towns.
$60,000 a piece.
Yeah.
Well, they're not all. Each town doesn't make
each town.
Depending on.
Yeah, like Essex just has the traps, so then they'd be included as a town. So
The green head.
It's not all the same, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, I believe it's Gloucester, Rockport, Essex, and Lawrence are not, just don't participate.
No, just, because Rockport really doesn't need it, because they don't have any openings, that's all.
This year, they've been awful, the green heads have been awful in my garage, my car's full of them.
I haven't noticed it at all.
They're all in my garage.
Oh, that's the wonder I.
It's a big trap.
These garage is black, though.
Oh, it's a great big trap, though.
You can keep them.
Yeah, I haven't had any trouble.
No, they're all too.
I don't even have a swimming pool, it's weird.
When you're ready.
Okay.
Next up.
I just want to vote for the minutes.
You have to vote for the minutes.
Yeah, okay. After Susan reads it.
Okay.
We have a motion to accept the minutes.
I will make that motion, that we accept the minutes.
Of the 18th day of April.
April 18th, 2018.
Second, John Melcher.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Goes. Okay, next up, set next meeting. January?
Do you want to look at the calendar, see what?
Yeah, we'll see what kind of, yeah. It's a good thing maybe not to meet in August, because it means more work for the office to pull things together. So we should maybe meet in September.
September's good.
Yeah. And then the concerns of the board?
None.
Not concerned about a thing.
Happy board?
Happy board.
Happy board, happy kids.
How's Ed?
He's doing good.
His birthday's today.
It is, yeah.
Wendy?
She's good.
Doing well? Office doing okay?
Yeah. Our longest serving senior aide, Ann, is gonna, this is her last year. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, so we'll have to bring her in.
Oh, we'll have to have a.
Something for her.
Oh, definitely.
I think it's.
When is she ending?
The end of this calendar year, so.
Yeah.
Susie finishes her hours, basically, yeah. But it's been, I don't know, 15, 17 years.
She's marvelous.
I can't, I don't, I've been here a long time. Yeah, so she's.
Yeah, she's been very good.
Yeah.
She is very good.
Well, we'll have to plan an event.
Something for her, yes, absolutely.
And that would be more around December.
Yeah, if you'd like, yeah.
Yep, so let's plan on that.
She's done a lot of work over the years, a lot of tedious work.
Yeah.
A lot of data entry, a lot of tracking, a lot of organizing.
Good.
Yep.
Well, that's it then, so have a motion to close the meeting at 8:00.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you, Frank.